3, 4. Rev up your engines. Today I'm going to show you how you can quickly get your car ready for winter before it's too cold and you don't want to come outside and do any of it. Now if you only do one thing, do this. Check your antifreeze. Now the reason you want to do it is this. Most things when they get cold, they shrink. But water, when it gets below 32 degrees Fahrenheit, it freezes and it actually expands. Anybody knows that. You can put water in an ice cube tray, fill it level, and then when you freeze it, you'll see it's above the level because it expands. That's not a good thing for your engine. Let's say you had a leak. You put just water in the coolant and forgot about it. If it freezes inside the engine, it will expand and it will crack your block, ruin your engine. And today it's even bigger of a problem because back in the day they had cast iron blocks which were stronger. These are all cast aluminum blocks in most cars. Aluminum is much softer than cast iron and it will crack much quicker. So here's how easy it is to check your antifreeze. You can get one of these testers dirt cheap at any auto parts store. Now you want to do it when the engine's cold. You just take the radiator cap off, in this case it's over here, squeeze some in, and as you can see here, it goes up minus 37 degrees Fahrenheit. Considering that I'm in Tennessee, minus 37 degrees Fahrenheit, probably not going to happen here. Very frequently, maybe back when the ice age was here, but not anymore, so it's totally safe. But you want to remember one thing when you use one of these low-cost testers. You do it when the engine's cold. Now, I can do the engine when it's hot with my fancy tester here. This is a refractometer, and it compensates for the temperature, but you're not gonna buy one of these expensive ones. So don't get mad at a mechanic if he tests your antifreeze when it's hot, if he has one of these, because it's temperature compensated. That isn't, so you wanna do it cold. And anyway, it's safer. When it's cold first thing in the morning like now, you're not gonna scald yourself with hot coolant. Now, the advantage of that clear tester shows off in more than one way. Not only is it easy to read, but you can see the coolant. You can see how pinkish this is. This uses the Toyota Haute coolant, hybrid, organic acid technology, the best coolant out there. You can see it's perfectly clean. If it was all gungy and there was dunk in it, then you need to flush out your coolant system. And you might think, oh, it's winter, it's not gonna overheat, I'm not gonna bother flushing it out. Well, let me tell you something else about that. The coolant in your radiator also runs the heater in your car. You don't want dirty coolant in your heater core. If it clogs up, you won't have any heat, and you won't be happy then either. Now, the next thing is, have your battery checked. Now, you can get your own battery tester if you want. Mine is very expensive, it's an $800 one. But any auto parts store will check it for free. It's not that big of a deal having it tested. Because when it gets cold, batteries lose a lot of their efficiency. If it's an old battery, these machines will tell you the percentage that's left. So you'll know, oh, gee, it's getting under 20%. I think I've changed it before it gets too cold. And battery technology has changed over the years. When I was a young mechanic, all batteries are pretty simple, lead acid batteries. And when they started to go out, your engine would go, and then start up, you know, uh-oh, the battery's going bad. I better replace it or get it tested. Most modern batteries are actually better made. They last a bit longer because of their internal build is stronger, but they often will give you no warning. You might not get the old You'll just get one day, you'll turn the key and the car won't start and you're stranded. And you can see it's simple to test them. One goes on a positive. One goes on a negative. And you push a button. And you set the cold cranking amps. In this case, cold cranking amps is 750. It's hiding under there. It's 750. Push a few buttons here. There we go. And that's it. We just push test and it tested. Health is 100%. Well, that's not surprising because I put this thing in about 6 months ago before we moved from Houston to Tennessee. I figured, hey, it's going to be colder in Tennessee, so I put a new battery in. But these days, you never know. It's a good idea to check them once or twice a year just to be on the safe side. And if you do need a new battery, hey, price around. I went to a discount auto parts store the other day for a customer. They wanted $179 for a battery. I ended up going to Walmart buying that same type of battery for $79. This is the main reason you want to check it ahead of time. If you get stranded somewhere, guess what? You're going to go to the nearest auto parts store, buy one. You're going to overpay. Don't get stuck in that. Plan ahead. Don't be like the grasshopper. be like the ant in the fable. Be prepared for winter. When the frost comes and you don't have any food and you freeze to death, hey, you want to be stuck in a parking lot with a dead battery in the winter? No. Now the next thing to check is your tire pressure. And just like the coolant test, you want to do it cold. As tires heat up, they expand, they get hot, the pressure actually goes up. Don't check a hot tire, check a cold one. And you want to check it when the weather turns cold for one reason. As a hot tire will read higher pressure, a cold tire will have a lot less pressure. So you check it first thing in the morning. Now, as you can see, this one's got 27 PSI. And guess what? When I left Houston, it was cold. I had 32 PSI. It's that much colder here than it was in Houston. So you want to do it first thing in the morning before you've driven and set it then. Because if you check it later in the day, it will be higher. But you want it to be the cold pressure when you check tires. And now in the olden days, guys would put snow tires on in the winter. This is front wheel drive. You would put them in the front. But with most cars these days, they're front wheel drive. Most of the weight is in the front, the engine and transmission, sitting on the tires. My mother, in her 90s, drove around Buffalo, New York in a Toyota Corolla and never put snow tires on it. She never got stuck and she never got in an accident. So you might not need snow tires anymore. Some of the treads on these tires, you get an all-season tire, are more aggressive than normal tires. If you live in an area where it snows a lot, maybe you'll go for an all-seasons tire because they can work perfectly fine in the winter. And while you're at it, check the tire out. See if it's all cracked. Well, these are brand new Michelins I had put on in the summer, so there's nothing wrong with them. But if they're starting to crack, guess what? You ever notice how your lips crack in the winter? The tires that are cracking, they'll crack even worse. You don't want to get a blowout and a snow and ice and you're out there jacking a car up trying to put on a spare because you had junky old tires on a car. It's big in a cracked rubber. Hey, check out your fan belts. Make sure they're smooth like this and aren't ripped or torn or cracked. Many modern cars have only one fan belt. They call them serpentine belts, drive belts. You know, I'm not a politically correct guy, so I still call them fan belts. You don't want them breaking and flinging off in the cold and stranding you in the middle of nowhere. Check it. Like today, it's a nice sunny day. Maybe it's cold, but it's a sunny day. Ha, you can change it out now when it's snowing and raining and sleeting. You don't want to be out there working on it. Do it before the weather turns bad. But if the weather does turn bad, all right, I learned something in Tennessee. Get one of these space heaters. They're super easy to use, and they don't cost much. You plug them in, turn on the propane, you push the button. There we go, heat. Now, I like the propane ones because you don't have to mess around with kerosene, that smell and all that nonsense. And in a pinch, they make great hair dryers. Yes, contrary to popular opinion, this is my real hair. So don't let winter catch you off guard this year. Do a little preventative maintenance first. And here's some bonus questions and answers. Actav says, can I put a used or new TCM without reprogramming it in a new car? Well, no, not unless your new car is a really old used car. Some of the cars, like Honda, some as early as 1995, they had ones that you had to reprogram or the vehicle wouldn't start. So all cars need to have that done. Now, mechanics do it, but there are certain companies that they also do it too. Like Napa, they'll do a lot of different cars. Now, some they can't do, like some of them can't do Lexus, but they can do GM, Ford, Chrysler, Toyota. Just call around to see what people can do, which ones, and then some of them can reprogram them, some of them can't. So if you need to change it, you'll know ahead of time where it's done, how you can have it, how much you're going to pay. Generally, you better find a local mechanic who's got the equipment. The equipment isn't that expensive for a mechanic. It costs about $1,000. They got to know how to use it, and they have to have a subscription for that particular manufacturer. So always call ahead of time to see what they can work on, what they're going to charge you. And if you think that's too much, see if you can find places that you send a computer to and it's programmed, or if you're buying it from them, if they can program it before they send it to you. Good Scotty says, hey, when you change your battery on an 09 Honda Civic, does anything need to be programmed? Thanks. You don't have to do anything. It's an 09 Civic. You can just put another battery in it. It might idle a little weird until you drive around and the computer recalibrates it to your driving. If you do have an anti-theft radio before you change the battery, make sure you have the code, because if you don't have the code, to get the code, you gotta pull the radio out and then look at the code on the back, or go to a Honda dealer, prove you own the car, and then they can can give you the code to reprogram the code. It's not like modern complex cars, but let's say you have an NSF radio. You don't want to mess with all that. You can get one of these memory savers where you just plug it into your data port. You can get them on Amazon for like $12. And then you plug it into the data port in the car. When you change the battery, the computer and everything has its memory saved, so then nothing happens. If you want to do that, go ahead and get one of those. They fit just about all cars. So if you never want to miss another one of my new car repair videos, remember to ring that bell.